allows you to quickly ship prototypes. Or, in fact, you can actually use your production code, right? Like, it's important to remember that moderation is key with most technologies. And so, don't take anything I say as dogmatic, one way extreme or the other. Take it, you know, like, for your specific use case, keep that in mind. So with that being said, the first thing I want to talk about is the unknown type. And unknown type, if you're not familiar, I'm going to give a quick example. So let's start off with any. So what's the behavior of any today? If you said anything is an any, even though it's a number, it's any. If you try to assign that to a string, it's going to be totally fine with this, because TypeScript, you're saying it's any type. I don't really care. However, with unknown, if you try to do the same thing, we're going to get a type error. And that's because TypeScript is basically saying, you're saying, I can assign any value to this, but then when I try and use it, like try and actually make, you know, call any method on it or assign it to a string, it's not going to allow that. So instead, what we need to do is we need to do some sort of runtime type assertion. You need to confirm both to yourself and to the compiler at runtime that it is, in fact, a number. Oh, okay, great. Now the compiler is totally fine with this. We can call toString on that and assign it to that variable, right? So that's unknown. The gist, it's basically the type-safe equivalent of any. And I really think that this is utilized a lot less than it should be. Like, in almost every case that you're using any, you could use unknown. Ultimately, it comes down to how loosey-goosey do you want to be with your type. Sometimes you just have to ship code, right? So it's not a big deal. So let's move on to the next example. This is an example where I've got this dog interface with some, you know, two fields, right? Let's say I wanted to make a type alias for the age. I could just say type age is a number, right, just like how I saw it there. However, I'm duplicating the code, and what happens is later I change age to be a string, or a date object, or something else. I have to update that in multiple places. And so, to solve this problem, there's a couple ways, but one of the ways you can do it is you do something called indexed access types, which is somewhat of a tongue twister, so hopefully I don't screw that up. But, and so instead of type age equals a number, we can say dog, and then use brackets with the string of age. And this is very similar to the syntax at runtime if you wanted to look up the property on a dog instance, except this is happening at compile time. Now we have an alias where anytime I would update the age property, the age type alias is going to be equivalent. If I wanted to, I could actually provide a union of other field names. So a union of name and age, and now I've got field values, which is a union of the string and number, because there's a string and a number field. However, as you can see, what happens if I added any field to dog? I would have to go and make sure that I've updated this union as well. So that's not good. There's a TypeScript feature to solve that. It's called key of. And so it's a keyword in TypeScript. If you say key of and then the type, you're going to get a union of string literals for every field of that type. So then what we can do is we can combine that with the previous example where we say field values equals dog, and then in brackets we can take that key of alias, and now it's all updated. So field values, if I update dog and change age or add a new field, we've got a union and a maintainable piece of code. Taking that one step further, let's say that you're writing a library or something and you have an array of object literals. You don't actually know the type of head ahead of time. It's up to the consumer of your library to define them. In this case, what we can do is you can use type of dogs first to get an array type of that. As you can see there, type dogs, the equivalent is right below it. And then you can use the same indexed access type, but instead of providing some other field name or something, you can just say number. And what that's going to do is going to give you the type for whatever the type is for the array's elements, if that makes sense. So an array has a type of for each one. So in this case, that's the dog type, right? So you can see it's the equivalent. We've got the name string, age, number. So moving right along, we've got another example. Let's say that you've got a union of colors. You've got red, blue, and then you've got the quantity, 1, 2, and then you're doing like a Dr. Seuss sort of thing. So you say 1 fish, 2 fish, red fish, blue fish. Well, you'll notice that this is another example of duplication. If I added a new color or added a new quantity, I have to make sure that stays in sync. Well, there's something called template string types, which can get really complex, so I kind of can use fairly simple examples. And in this case, you can do interpolation. You can, just like you would do at runtime with a string, you can interpolate the types. So you can create a string interpolated, taking the union of color and quantity, and it generates then those string literals dynamically at compile time so that it's completely in sync and updated. So that, and this can be very powerful. If you've ever seen, so like if you have like, if you had an object where you're passing event listeners, and you say like on foo or something like that, you can actually use this syntax to extract and manipulate strings at compile time. Now keep in mind, this doesn't work with runtime strings, like strings that are generated at runtime, like provided from a user or a database or something like that. You don't know what those values are ahead of time, so it only works with compile time things. And one of the things I wanted to talk about is utility types. Now there are a ton of utility types. These are types that are built into TypeScript as a language, so to do some of the most common things, like making all the fields required, or making all the fields optional, or extracting out a particular field. Chances are, if you want to do it, by now TypeScript has provided these utility types to help you do that. But you know, I don't have a ton of time, so I don't want to go through every single one of these. So instead, I'm just going to go through one of them, and it is called this type, because I feel like this is one of the least known of these utility types. And so let's take an example. Let's say we have this function. And it's called makeDog, and it takes two arguments. You've got data and methods, and then you're going to spread both of those together. We're going to combine them into one single object. If we were calling it, you know, we might pass some state as the first argument, and then the next argument we pass those methods, right? And that function is going to combine them together, so dog is just one single object where both of those things have been merged together. And then you might assign properties or call move to or something like that. Now, if we were to add types to this, we're going to very quickly run into a type error. We're going to see property Y does not exist on type move 2. And that's because, as you can see, as far as TypeScript is concerned, I have this object, and when I use this dot Y or this dot X or something like that, it's referring to that object, right? The object that you declare this in. And that's not actually true. So if we go into this makeDog, we can see that we're saying that, okay, D is an object, and M is an object, and so the data is D, and methods is M, these are both objects, but what we're not telling TypeScript is that we're spreading those together, that we've changed what this context is going to be, when in fact that method is called. And so that's where you can create an intersection type, where you intersect M with this type, and then pass in an intersection of D and M. So what that's doing is you're telling TypeScript, at runtime, if any of these methods are called on this object, what's going to happen is it's going to have the this of the intersection of D and M. Both of those objects have been combined and created that intersection. Now, we have no type errors, and there's no problems. Now, this is somewhat of a contrived example, because obviously, like, why would you say make dog and spread these together? Really where it comes and it becomes beneficial is when you've got more complex abstractions. So, the big thing I want to stress about all of these things is that the goal is to increase productivity, right, and to add confidence to your code. The goal is never to make everything 100% type safe, because it's a fool's errand and you're not going to be productive. Shipping is by far the most important part of that. And so, with that, I'm just going to close it out, and if I have any questions, I can take them now. Questions? Yes, sir. Oh, I don't know if they're. Are you guys doing mics for questions? I assumed you could just yell it out.
Oh, dear.
Sorry about that. Thank you.
So.
Yeah, so you can use afterwards we can
You mentioned a lot of the built-in types, like pig, emit, union. Which of those do you find using? Which of those do you find yourself using most in your day-to-day actual coding?
I would say, in day-to-day, I'm not using these all the time. Really, it's like for most of these, it's more setting up abstractions. I've said that the most advanced types, day-to-day, most of the time we're just dealing with interfaces and functions and takes and more of this. Really, when you start to create complex abstractions to make your life easier for libraries or things like that, that's where these things kind of become very useful. And so the ones I use, when I'm doing that, which I do end up doing a lot of, I end up using, I would say, omit, pick, record. I've used partial a number of times. The ones that are, I wish I would have gone through the constructor parameters, and that was a really cool one, being able to extract those out. You couldn't do that for a very long time. So when TypeScript released that, it opened up a lot of possibilities. There's a couple that I very rarely use, like the omit this parameter. I've used parameters quite a bit. It turns parameters into a type of turns a tuple of the arguments for that. And that's super powerful as well, especially when you can spread creating new arguments. Yeah, no problem. Any other questions?